Good evening, brethren. Greetings in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. This message was put in my heart for the body of Christ. To the world and the people of the world, and it seems increasingly the people in the church, the people who call themselves by the name of the Lord, who may be sitting next to you or in the pew in front of you, the words that I'm going to speak are foolishness. What I'm going to recount is an observation of history. History is simply the recounting of the truth of the past and the tellings of the happenings of humans who went before us. It is a critically important part of our life, though very few people find it so today. In fact, by simple observation in the news of the day, we see now that truth has become relative in almost every aspect of our society. You may be a man and call yourself a woman, and society applauds. You can major in universities in applied history and be a revisionist of it. You can be of European descent and simply by your feelings and emotions relate to other ethnicities and then claim their heritage based upon your perception of truth. History, the historical record of words, actions, and deeds, warnings, and revelations, history and the study of it allows us to see into the future. I find this a remarkable thing. Allow me to form an allegory or an analogy. When we are driving on the road, we see in front of us signs. And by the use of language and symbolism, these signs act as a warning for what lies ahead. Though once we see the sign and pass it, it is history. We have the choice to obey the signs and the history they present to us, or not. We have the choice to obey and heed the warnings, or not. I was awakened in the middle of the night to a simple historical revelation that history, that is the warnings and revelations that were spoken thousands of years ago, are now, this very day, our current reality. And just as a road sign that just passed by our window, for the sake of all those who are passengers with me during this present time or age in which we are traveling, I have been positioned in a place to communicate to those who may be watching the scenery or viewing their portable electronic devices, or maybe just so in love with themselves and their lives that they are not aware of the signs, or perhaps they are simply struggling to work, pay the bills, and feed the family, that their attention has been diverted from the signs of warning that are telling of the road ahead. For whatever reason, I have been made hyper-aware of what lies ahead. Or maybe it's just that through the revelation of history, that my thoughts are not centered nor concerned with all of the shiny things that surround us to distract us from the truth. Yes, I said truth. Like evil, there is truth. And the truth is that history relates to us very transparently the circumstances that are now facing us. The truth is we have been warned to, one, love God above all else and love our neighbor as we love ourselves, and two, that we as humans, though the majority cannot yet imbibe the truth of it, we are called to recognize that we do not live by earthly food or physical sustenance alone, but by every word that is spoken by the mouth of God. Around 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ the Nazarene said, "Watch out that no one or person deceive you. For many people will come in my name claiming I am the Messiah and will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come." Nation, and in the Greek, the word nation is correlated to ethnos, or in modern English, ethnicities, will rise against nation. And kingdoms, in Greek, governments, will rise against kingdoms. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All of these are the beginning of birth pains. Then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death. You will be hated of all nations because of your testimony of Jesus Christ. At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. But the one who stands firm to the end will be saved, and the gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations. And then the end will come. Notice here that the reason we will be hated will be the same reason Jesus was hated. It was not for any other reason than for his word. The word was not that God loves you. It was not that you are special to God and that God desires for you to live in peace and prosperity. The word was this: repent. Humble yourselves before the one who created you and turn from your carnal, sinful nature. Turn from your pursuit of your will or die to it, that Christ may be alive in you, that by his grace you may fulfill his will and be about his business, building his kingdom by being pursuers and practitioners of truth, leading people into his word, being sanctified, set apart by his word, for his word is truth. Amen. Unfortunately, there are very few men today who will say this. In the New Testament, in the second book of Peter, chapter 2, it says, "But there were also false prophets among the people, just as there will be false teachers amongst us today. They will secretly introduce destructive heresies." This, beloved, is happening today across all of Western Christianity, thought and doctrine, simply because our generation is biblically illiterate and has placed their dependence upon man and man's word and are not hearing from God, to which reason Jesus died, that we all might have direct access to God, his word and his spirit, that man might not corrupt it. Even denying the sovereign Lord who brought them, bringing upon them swift destruction upon themselves. Many will follow their depraved conduct and will bring the way of truth into disrepute. In their greed, these teachers will exploit you with fabricated stories. Very few men will expose human nature as being selfish and evil. Very few men, therefore, speak of the truth. Many are speaking of the name of Jesus, but by historical reference, it is not Jesus Christ whose words and character are displayed in the writings of the New Testament. Rather, they are teaching the doctrines of men. And men are, as the modern world and culture lays very transparent to us today, and very plain to see, men are evil, as we were warned by historical account. In the second epistle of Timothy, chapter 3, and please, beloved, recognize this is written to the church. This is not written to the world. This is written to those of us to warn us who call ourselves by the name of Jesus Christ. And it is written, "But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days, for people will be lovers of themselves, of money, they'll be boastful, they'll be proud and abusive, they'll be disobedient to their parents, they'll be ungrateful, they won't be holy, they'll have no love, they'll be unforgiving and slanderous, they'll have no self-control, they'll be brutal, they won't love what's good, they'll be treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form, or it could be said, having a verbal profession of godliness, but denying its power." We're told to have nothing to do with such people. In order to see, we must take our eyes off of ourselves, our problems, our circumstances, and yes, our religious leaders, our pastors and priests, and place our eyes upon Jesus and his word. We must recognize that the words of the New Testament are to the believers, those who call themselves followers of Jesus Christ. The people who are outside of the testimony of the reality of Jesus Christ find what is being said here absolute foolishness, myth and fairy tales. But to us who believe, It is the power of God unto salvation. To the world, and actually today to most of what is called the church, these words are fable, a story of fiction. At best, a wonderfully illustrated story. The warnings of Jesus in the letters to the church, that is those who call themselves again believers in Jesus Christ, and the words of the New Testament are to us today. Why would the writings of 2,000 years ago pay homage and give warning to the lives of those who live today? Why are the signs along life's road speaking to our modern circumstances and situations? Again, 2 Epistle of Peter, chapter 3. To us, above all, we must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come. These are people in the church, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, where is the promise of his coming? Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it had been since the beginning of creation. This implies that these people believe in creation, but yet they're far from the will of God. Verse 5 says, but they deliberately forget that long ago by God's word. Notice what's said here. They deliberately forget. Deliberately forget that long ago by God's word the heavens came into being and the earth was formed out of the water and by water. These waters also, the world at the time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. These words are written to the body of Christ today. These words are being spoken by the world's discernment of what is the gathering of people who call themselves by the name of Jesus Christ and gather within the walls of what is called by the world a church on Sunday morning. They will scoff at the word written in the Bible. They will create for themselves a level of moral, judicial, and personal law that they and the society of which they are a part of are comfortable with. Here is how we can discern the falsehood. Any one or combination of these tenets. They will not speak of nor on repentance and the importance of maintaining a repentant, contrite, and humble heart before God, which was and is Christ's ministry. They will not speak of, nor on, the obedience of, nor to the commandments of Jesus Christ. They will actually desire to revise and rewrite them. They will not speak of eternity or the consequences of sin being hell. They will not speak of the only atonement or the bridge to the Creator being the blood of Jesus Christ. They will accept that which society as a whole accepts. They will embrace that which the culture which they are surrounded by embraces. They will espouse tolerance as being the bridge to unity, unless that definition of tolerance includes the gospel of Jesus Christ. The tolerance of which they espouse will culminate in the manifestation of the abomination. Isaiah 29:13 says, wherefore the Lord said, for as much as the people draw near to me with their mouth and with their lips do honor me, but have removed their heart far from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the perceptions of men, because they do not know the word, therefore do not know God nor his righteous requirements. They will bow down to the idols of their own making, the idols of their own hearts. Jeremiah 13:10 tells us, this evil people which refuse to hear my words, which walk in the imagination of their own heart, and walk after other gods to serve them and to worship them, shall even be as a girdle, a shirt, a piece of clothing, which is good for nothing. Proverbs 16:5 tells us, everyone that is proud in heart is an abomination to the Lord. Though hand join in hand, and there be visible signs of unity in the world, those people shall not be unpunished. Malachi 2:17 warns us, you have wearied the Lord with your words, yet you say, wherein have we wearied him? The Lord says, when you say, everyone that doeth evil is good in the sight of the Lord, and he delighteth in them? Or where is the God of judgment? It will be the ultimate act of idolatry, and it will culminate in the formation of the ultimate act of religion, which will state that all religions, yea, all faiths, all worship the same power or God, but reference it by different names and in different ways. All this will take place simply because people fail to, as we're warned in the second book of Timothy, chapter 2, study to show ourselves approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightfully dividing the word of truth. The result of this behavior of conforming to the image of tolerance for unity's sake will be Jeremiah 4:22. For my people is foolish. They have not known me. They are silly children, and they have no understanding. They are wise to do evil, but to do good, they have no knowledge. And in Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject you, that thou shalt be no priest to me. Seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget your children. And Isaiah warns us in chapter 5, verse 20, woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. The Psalm of David 14:1, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They have done abominable works. There is none that doeth good. All this simply because man will wander from the relationship with God's holy word and unto trusting into it. Jeremiah 17:9 tells us the heart is deceitfully wicked above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Only one, and that's God. Man apart from God cannot see the wickedness in his own heart. That is precisely how sin and death entered into the world, through man trusting in himself and not God. God knows it. That is why he, in his wisdom and holy nature, gave unto us his word and said that in Matthew 24:35, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words shall not pass away. Joshua 24:15 tells us, and if it seems evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. The signs, beloved, are all around us. We are passing them with breakneck speed. The images they produce are forming into an amalgamation that is so evil and so contrary to the truth and righteousness of God's word that the fruit of this sowing will soon manifest in a deception that is so shrouded in darkness that only those whose hearts are singly eye fixed upon the truth of Jesus Christ will have the ability to see it. It is my prayer that those who hear this message test the spirits, and the only spiritual device by which to do so is God's written word. Luke 21:36, pray that you be found worthy to escape those things that come upon the earth and stand before the Son of Man. Blessings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.